In 1942, the United States was waging war on two fronts and faced a severe shortage of pilots. Two forward-thinking pilots, Jackie Cochran and Nancy Love, approached Air Corps leaders with a big idea, an experimental program that would train women to fly military aircraft so male pilots could be released for combat duty overseas. Word spread to the First Lady, Eleanor Roosevelt. The Army Air Corps decided to get on board, and the Women Air Force Service Pilots, or WASPs, were born. In 1944, during the graduation ceremony for the last WASP training class, the commanding general of the U.S. Army Air Forces, General Hap Arnold, said that when the program started, he wasn't sure whether a slip of a girl could fight the controls of a B-17 in heavy weather. Now in 1944, it is on the record that women can fly as well as men, Arnold said. A few more than 1,000 young women of an applicant pool of over 25,000 finished training and flew almost every type of military aircraft as part of the WASP program. Competition was fierce, and the women selected already averaged over 1,400 hours of flight time, many already with a commercial pilot's license. Among with their many duties, the WASPs ferried new planes long distance from factories to military bases and departure points across the country. They tested newly developed warplanes, and they towed targets to give ground and air gunners training shooting with live ammunition. One of these amazing women is still alive today, Nell Stevenson Bright. We felt like we had the best of both worlds, because we had so many different airplanes to fly and flew so many different kinds of missions. We had the same training as the men, and we flew everything that they had in the Air Force at the time. Nell Stevenson was 19 years old and a college graduate of West Texas A&M when, in 1940, an article about the Army Air Corps recruiting women caught her eye. It was an opportunity for us not only to do something for our country, which needed us at the time, but it was actually fulfilling a dream to really use our flying or something that was really needed and that we wanted to do, Nell said, reflecting back. Recently, our very own senior airman Chloe Holmes got the opportunity to sit down and talk with Nell Bright. Please enjoy this segment from that interview.
I was raised in West Texas, right close to Amarillo, Texas. And when I was 8 years old, my dad took me out to see one of the old World War I airplanes, the Barnstormers that went through that part of the country landing. And he said, did I want to go up? And I said, sure. So I went up when I was 8 years old in this old cockpit. And I thought that was the most fun, and I must have kept that in the back of my mind because I finished college there in Canyon, which is close to Amarillo, when I was 19, and then I decided to go ahead and take flying lessons. We had had a civilian pilot training thing there at the university, West Texas University, but the instructors had a daughter, and she got the one space that they've had for a woman. So anyway, that's after I finished college, as I said, went to Amarillo and started flying lessons. Got my private license and 75 hours of flying time within a couple of years. And about that time, Jacqueline Cochran was organizing the women training division for the Army Air Corps, because that was right after Pearl Harbor, and we did not have enough pilots. And she talked General Arnold and President Roosevelt into having an experiment of training women pilots. We had our training at Sweetwater, Texas, and had all our primary, basic, and advanced all in one base. Had the same training as the men from daylight till after dark. we would fly in the morning, Brown School in the afternoon, and link trainer and other things at night, and into bed at 10 o'clock and up at 5. Then in between any free time we had, we did the calisthenics and just everything. And part of the time we would fly over to a flat surface of ground, which it is in that part of Texas. And practice landings, we would go over to an auxiliary field, we called it, and practice our spot landings. So we did that, but we finished then up, we flew the open cockpit PT-19 for primary, and the BT-13 for basic, the AT-6 Texan for advanced, and in advanced we did twin-engine CC-28. And took us 6 months because we didn't take any leave time in between that. And we got our orders then to go to, part of the girls would go to the ferry command, and then Jack and Cochran was sending girls to different places to do different things. And there were 20 of us chosen out of our class. I was in the 7th class. And there were 20 of us chosen to go to B-25 transition school at Mather Field, Sacramento, California. We went there in November. By the middle of February, we had locked about 165 hours flying time and had our first pilot and instrument rating on the B-25. Ten of us were sent to El Paso, Texas. I was one of that group. The other 10 were sent to March Field in Riverside, California. There we towed targets behind B-25s and B-26s. We would have a crew chief with us, or whatever he wanted to be called. And then we had great big target sleeves, big target, long target sleeves. And they would be rolled out from the back of the airplane. 2,500 feet. Usually they were red, so they could see them. And that was, and then they would shoot at the target. They were learning to shoot at the target. Fortunately, they never did hit our airplane.
Let's hope they were good shots.
I was flying, towing targets on B-25 one night because they were supposed to find the target with searchlights. And then the gunners could shoot at the target in the searchlight. Except the flak started breaking in front of us instead of behind us. And we had to do a little evasive action and cut the target and let it fly wherever it wanted to and call the ground control and told them what was happening and we were going back to base. When they learned to shoot better, we'd come back and try again. Oh, that was the closest we came to their bullets. But anyway, and we did all kinds of things, training them to go into combat. We strafed the troops as they went out into the desert. These were troops from Fort Bliss, right across the highway from Biggsville. And we would strafe them at sunrise in the morning in P-47s and A-24s and A-25s, the two Navy helicopters. And at night, we would fly the twin-engine beach, the AT-7 and AT-11, on a pattern and training the boys to use the searchlights. So we just had a pattern to fly, and they were supposed to find us. And then, of course, we had ground school too, with the B-25. But and then when we were at Mather. Then when we had a few minutes off, we of course would get acquainted with everybody in the whole squadron, and that was about, as I said, some of the girls went to the ferry command. Others of us did other things, like we did, were towed targets and stuff. And some of them worked for the weather department. Some of them flew VIPs, and some of them trained the bombardiers that were training to be bombardiers for those. So we felt like that we're doing a pretty good job, but the war was winding down, so we did. They decided that decided not to militarize us. They voted that down because we were technically civil service, and everybody thought we were officers. We were treated like officers, but we were not technically military. So when that was had to go through Congress for us to be military, and Congress voted it down. And then Jackie Cochran just said, well, okay, if you don't want us to fly anymore, we'll be getting out of here. So between she and General Arnold, they decided that. And at the end of 1944, December 20th, we were deactivated and sent home with no veteran benefits and everything. And it was, quite a shocking thing to say, okay, they didn't pay our way home or anything. Well, some of us, I had a car, so I drove home. But it was a wonderful time, and we felt like that we were really contributing and helping our country because they needed us. We flew here in the States to relieve the men to go overseas to go into combat. And we had no, as I told you before, we had no veterans benefits. And I guess we didn't think too much about it at the time, but in 1977, they came out with, the Air Force came out with a big announcement that they were, for the first time in history, they were going to train women pilots to fly military airplanes. And we decided it was time we spoke up. And so we went through Congress again with Barry Goldwater's help. And we finally got our veterans benefits in 1977.
Definitely well earned.
So it was a wonderful experience for us. And of course, there were 10 of us that worked together the whole time. We stayed in touch, forever. I'm the only one left now. The camaraderie, that was so important too. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we had done all it together, and at that time didn't think too much about whether we were making history or anything. Mm-hmm.
Making history, that's a good way to sum it up.
The head of the WASP program was Jacqueline Cochran, who went on to become the first woman to break the sound barrier, as well as break more speed and distant records than any other aviator, male or female. Many other WASPs went on to break records, including Anne Baumgartner, who became the first woman to fly a jet aircraft testing the new P-59 right here at Wright Field. Another WASP, Chinese-American Hazel Ying Li, quickly emerged as a leader among the WASPs. Described as calm and fearless, she once made a forced landing in a Kansas field when her engine failed. A farmer, armed with a pitchfork, chased Li around her plane as he shouted that the Japanese were invading. Li was known as a bit of a prankster, writing mystery messages in Mandarin on the tails of the other planes with her signature bright lipstick. A favorite of her wingmen, Hazel tragically gave the ultimate sacrifice during a ferry mission to Alaska. Jackie Cochran's goal was to train thousands of women to fly for the Army. She wanted a separate women's organization and believed militarization would follow if the program was a success. And a success it was. The women's safety records were comparable or better than their male counterparts doing the same jobs. The WASP program was successful in every sense of the word, but in 1944, the program came under threat. With the war winding down, flight training programs were closing down, and male instructors were losing their jobs. Men lobbied hard for the women's jobs. Consequently, the program would disband by December 1944. The WASPs, who had served so honorably, were dismissed without ceremony. Not a darn thing. It was told to us that we would be leaving the base and we hopped airplanes to get back home, said WASP Lillian Yonnelly. Many had to pay their own way home, and none were recognized for their service in any official manner. Not until 1977, after decades of fighting, did these brave women finally receive full veteran benefits. In 2010, 65 years after their service, they received the well-deserved Congressional Gold Medal. The United States Air Force owes a debt of gratitude to these trailblazers who showed what women can bring to the fight. Today we are proud to honor their legacy and tell their story. They show us why theirs is often called the greatest generation.